Today, I'm going to teach you how the oxygen from the air you breathe gets to your muscles and tissues. It involves anatomy, chemistry, biology, and a little bit of physics. Let's get into it. Hello and welcome. My name is Patrick, and if you're new here, this channel is all about anatomy and physiology. We'll start with an overview of respiratory anatomy to get our bearings. In this diagram, we're looking at someone from the front, so this is their right side, this is their left side. And I clarify that because the lungs aren't symmetrical. The right lung has three lobes, while the left lung has two lobes. When a breath enters the mouth or nose, it goes down the airway until it terminates at microscopic alveoli, or air sacs. These things are situated right next to really thin blood vessels called the pulmonary capillaries. This is where gas exchange actually happens, and it's where we'll spend most of the time talking about the movement of oxygen and carbon dioxide. We have a lot of these alveoli, around 500 million of them. But breathing happens because muscles let us inhale and exhale, so let's talk about those muscles. Right below the lungs, you'll find a dome-shaped muscle called the diaphragm, and this muscle is a huge deal when it comes to breathing. See, your lungs don't have any muscles of their own, but healthy lungs are really compliant, or elastic and bouncy. So if they're being moved around by a muscle, they'll just go along for the ride. And during a normal breath, the diaphragm contracts along with the external intercostal muscles, or muscles between the ribs. There are other muscles that can help us breathe when we're in trouble, like the scalenes or the sternocleidomastoid, but for the vast majority of healthy breaths, we can focus on the diaphragm. When it contracts, it expands the space, or volume, inside the chest. But when you change the volume of a container, like the lungs, you end up changing the pressure of the gases inside it. At its core, pressure is the force exerted by the liquids or gases against the walls of their container. You can increase pressure by increasing the number of collisions in the container, which you can do by increasing the amount of gas inside something, or by shrinking down the container. In this case, the volume of the container, the lungs, increases, so the pressure on the air molecules inside decreases, and vice versa. As the volume decreases when we exhale, pressure inside the lungs increases. This is where another physics law comes in. Whenever there's a difference in pressure between two gases and they're connected somehow, their pressures will tend to equalize. That means that a gas will move from areas of high pressure to low pressure. It doesn't matter if we're talking about gas molecules in a weather system or in our physiology. Gases tend to flow from areas of high pressure to low pressure. You can think of the greater than, less than sign. If the pressure is greater in container A than in container B, think of that greater than sign as an arrow that's pointing in the direction of the movement. A greater than B is the same thing as A to B. This is the entire basis of our lesson today. When our nose or mouths are open to the outside environment, the pressure inside our lungs is constantly trying to equalize with the atmosphere. When you take a breath and expand your chest's volume, you lower the total pressure of air inside your lungs. Since air flows from high pressure to low pressure, air flows into your lungs. Cool, so at this point, we understand how bulk air gets in and out of our lungs. That's the process of ventilation. Now we have to get that stuff from the lungs into the bloodstream, or what's called perfusion. The air we breathe is a mixture of different gases, mostly nitrogen and oxygen, but there's some water vapor and carbon dioxide in there too. When we measure pressure, we're measuring all of the collisions in that mixture at the same time, the collective force exerted by all the different gases. But to understand how gases get into the bloodstream, we need to know the pressure exerted by one gas at a time. This is called the partial pressure of a gas. It's like asking, how many collisions were solely because oxygen molecules were bouncing against the walls of the container? We can figure out that number, that pressure, by multiplying the percentage of the gas in the mixture by the total pressure of the mixture. For example, atmospheric pressure is 760 millimeters of mercury at sea level. Since nitrogen is about 78.6% of air, nitrogen has a partial pressure of 597.4 millimeters of mercury. Likewise, oxygen is 21% of air, and 21% of 760 comes out to 160 millimeters of mercury. At 400 parts per million in atmosphere, carbon dioxide has a partial pressure of 0.3 millimeters of mercury, and at 400th of a percent in atmosphere, water vapor has a partial pressure of 3 millimeters per mercury. But partial pressure depends on the composition of the gases in the air sample you're talking about. The air in our alveoli, for instance, has way more water vapor in it than the air around us, so the partial pressure of water vapor is higher inside our lungs than outside of our lungs. Let's zoom into an alveoli and a pulmonary capillary to see see what we're working with. Each alveoli is going to have a mixture of gases in it. The big difference is that there's going to be more carbon dioxide and more water vapor than in the air around us. Carbon dioxide because it's a waste product that we're trying to breathe out, and water vapor because we want our airway to be nice and humid. The alveoli does have the same total pressure as the outside air, though, so we'll assume 760 millimeters of mercury. But because the composition of gases is different, each gas has a different partial pressure compared to outside air. If we break down the percentages and partial pressures, the alveoli is 74.9% nitrogen with a partial pressure of 569 millimeters of mercury, 13.7% oxygen for a partial pressure of 104, 6.2% water vapor for 47, and 5.2% carbon dioxide for 40 millimeters of mercury. And just like with bulk air, gases will flow from areas of high partial pressure to low partial pressure. In this case, we're interested in the partial pressure differences between the alveoli and the pulmonary capillaries around them. If the partial pressure of a gas is greater in the alveoli, it will flow into the capillary and vice versa. Although that depends on how easily that gas dissolves in the blood too. Nitrogen gas doesn't dissolve well in blood, so very little actually transfers from alveoli to the bloodstream. Nitrogen is important for other biological processes like the urea cycle, but we get that nitrogen from the food we eat, not the air we breathe. So we'll focus on oxygen and carbon going forward. Oxygen gas isn't super soluble in blood either, but there's a big enough partial pressure difference between the alveoli and the capillaries that it does move in. Let's say we took a sample of blood from the pulmonary capillaries. On the left side of the diagram is deoxygenated blood coming from the right side of the heart. On the right side of the diagram will be oxygenated blood going to the left side of the heart to be pumped into systemic circulation. That deoxygenated blood has a partial pressure of oxygen of only 40 millimeters of mercury. Compare that to the 104 millimeters of mercury in the alveoli. That big of a difference in partial pressure causes oxygen to flow from the alveoli into the bloodstream, even though oxygen isn't all that soluble. Once they're in the blood, those molecules of oxygen bind to proteins in our red blood cells called hemoglobin. If you want to get more in depth on that process, check out my video up here or down in the description. Okay, so now oxygen is in the blood and the partial pressure of oxygen jumps to 100 millimeters of mercury. That number will stay consistent until we drop oxygen off at the tissues. Meanwhile, that deoxygenated blood has quite a bit of carbon dioxide in it. And CO2 is soluble in blood, so it freely flows from alveoli to blood and vice versa. The partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the alveoli is 40 millimeters of mercury, while it's about 45 millimeters of mercury in the pulmonary capillary. This causes CO2 to flow out of the bloodstream so it can be exhaled. Meanwhile, there's still plenty of CO2 in your arterial blood for a partial pressure of 40 millimeters of mercury. About 20% of it is bound to the globin chains in hemoglobin, but about 70% of it is dissolved in the blood in the form of bicarbonate, or HCO3. The rest of it is just dissolved in the blood plasma. Everything that's happened up to this point is called external respiration. The next part is called internal respiration. We need to drop off oxygen at the tissues and collect the carbon dioxide waste. At this point, we're in systemic circulation. The partial pressure of oxygen in the blood is 104 millimeters of mercury, and the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is 40 millimeters of mercury. Let's say we're at the quadricep muscles. The partial pressure of oxygen in those tissues is about 40 millimeters of mercury, which isn't a coincidence. The partial pressure of oxygen in deoxygenated blood is exactly the same as in muscle tissue at rest. The same phenomenon happens with CO2. The partial pressure we saw at the pulmonary capillaries just reverses. So the partial pressure of CO2 in the muscle is about 45 millimeters of mercury. So now we've got some gradients to work with. Oxygen flows from its high partial pressure in the blood to its low partial pressure in the muscle, and CO2 flows from muscle to blood. At this point, I want you to take a breath. Take a common sense check. You know that your muscles consume oxygen and make CO2 as a waste product. You know, before any numbers get involved, that oxygen moves from blood to muscle, and CO2 from muscle to blood. So you know that the partial pressure of oxygen has to be higher in the blood, and the partial pressure of CO2 has to be higher in the muscle than in the blood. Remember our greater than arrow from before, and you can always do a little logic check. So if you understand the partial pressure gradients from external respiration, you'll have no trouble with internal respiration. But I want to take a closer look at how those gases are exchanged at the tissue level. Our cells use glucose and turn it into ATP for energy. If we take glucose and oxygen, we turn it into carbon dioxide and water via cellular respiration. After our cells metabolize that sugar, we dump CO2 into the blood. Like I said before, a small percentage of it dissolves into the blood plasma, but most of it enters the red blood cell. Okay, now we're in deoxygenated venous blood. It flows back to the right side of the heart where it's pumped into pulmonary circulation. Then the whole process starts over again. The partial pressure of oxygen is lower than in the alveoli, so oxygen flows into the blood again. Now, here's the big paradox. Partial pressure gradients explain how gases move when they're free-floating, but those gases are all bound up in hemoglobin, and depending on whether the blood is at the pulmonary capillaries or at the tissues, we ask it to either bind as much new oxygen as possible or let go of as much oxygen as possible. Same thing with CO2. So, I put together a video about the Bohr effect and Haldane effect, the things that you're going to need to know to understand how this phenomenon works. You can check that video out right here. Before you go, if you learned something today, consider liking the video and subscribing. I especially want to thank my patrons on Patreon for their financial support. Have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.